As you all know, we are conducting a special series of videos to celebrate World Autism Day. And as I promised, we have an expert to talk about behavior therapy and autism. She is Mrs. Ishanti Pereira. And Ishanti is a consultant behavior analyst and an ABA therapist and a special need consultant. And she has more than 15 years experience in the field of applied behavior analysis and working with special needs population both in Sri Lanka and in North America. Currently, she is a practitioner as a consultant at RCRE Hospital and ABC School of Early Learning. So we are privileged to have you here, Ishanti.
Thank you, Nimiro, for having me on the show. It's an honor to be here, and thank you for your very flattering introduction.
So we are going to begin our conversation with one of the very famous questions. Because when a child comes to me, if I have realized that there is a component that a behavior therapist can address, when I introduced a behavior therapy pathway, when I say that it's better and this is the high time for you to consult a behavior therapist, most of the parents are asking from me, what is behavior therapist and who is behavior therapist? So I think it's better if we can start from that particular question. So Ishanti, what is behavior therapy?
That's a really good question, Nimira. So behavior therapy is a therapy approach to understand the function of behavior. So when we talk about functions of behavior, what we are talking about is why a child is behaving the way they are. What is the function? What is the goal? What are they trying to achieve by behaving like this? So the typical functions that we talk about would be access to an item. So we call it access to a tangible, access for attention, to either escape or avoid a certain situation or a certain activity, or for some kind of to meet or avoid some kind of sensory need. Another one that we can add to this is a child is behaving in this certain way because they don't have the skill to behave in another way. So what behavior therapy does is we identify what is the function of behavior, and then we take this maladaptive behavior, so now the behavior that has become the problem, and we try and replace it with a more socially appropriate functional behavior. So that is the whole goal of behavior therapy. I hope that answers your question.
Yes, okay. So in your title, it says you are an ABA therapist. So what is this applied behavior analysis and behavior therapy? Is it same or it's two different things?
So applied behavior analysis is a functional, is a scientific approach to understanding behavior. So we take these ABA principles, these scientifically proven techniques, and we apply it to the therapy that we are doing, which is behavior therapy, to try and either eliminate negative behaviors or to try and teach positive behaviors. So ABA and behavior therapy are different in that sense. ABA would more be the principles that we are using, and we are taking those principles and applying it to this kind of therapy to get the results that we want.
So if it's such an interesting area, how come many parents in Sri Lanka don't know about, haven't heard about behavior therapy? Do you guess any reasons?
Yeah, actually it's really important. I mean, behavior therapy is a fascinating subject. It's a really important area, but it's more, I suppose the education and clinical background is more North American or more in Europe, in Australia. It only recently even has come to India. So a lot of families in, I suppose, more in Colombo who have better access to technology and do their own research. A lot of those families have traveled to India or to Australia to receive this treatment, which is actually available over here now. So I think that is probably the reason. It's more North American, it's more European, it's taken time to come to Sri Lanka. So a lot of healthcare professionals also may not know that this exists over here. But it certainly is, it's valid, it's a scientifically proven approach, it's something that parents really should look into for their children.
Okay. And some people say behavior therapy and occupational therapy is the same, is it?
I don't think so. Now, I'm not sure how to define occupational therapy because, I'm not an occupational therapist. But behavior therapy is all about understanding the functions of behavior and teaching children more socially appropriate functional behavior. So behavior, so if you think about ABA principles, they're actually used in organizational psychology, they're used in mainstream typical classrooms, it's used everywhere. So it's just about, now we always talk about how children with special needs learn differently, right? Okay, so we'll identify how they are learning and we'll take these same principles and we'll apply to that particular way that they are learning. Because at the end of the day, we want them to have socially functional behaviors, right? So that's what this is all about.
So this is not only for children with special needs?
Of course not, no. Actually, I'm sure, Nimira, you and I use it every day when we are bringing up our own children. We may not really think of it that way because it's habitual for us. It's what our parents have done. It's worked. So we use it. So we don't really think what is the strategy we're using or what are the principles we're using here. But when it comes to applying this to the special needs population, simply because they are they learn things differently, they get information and stimulation from the environment differently, we need to teach them differently. So it's about, then you have to think, right, now what are the strategies I use? How can I apply that to this situation?
So today we are talking about ASD.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you think, how can behavior therapy help in help for people with ASD? So what is your experience with ASD and what is your opinion about behavior therapy for children with ASD, individuals with ASD?
So, since returning to Sri Lanka, I've been mainly working with the preschool population. And a lot of the issues that I see would be those skill building issues. So the child does not have the skills or what we call the prerequisite skills to be in a classroom. So a lot of the work that I do with younger children over here would be to first of all assess them and understand, okay, what is it that's missing? Sometimes children don't have the ability to sit for more than 2 minutes. So then how can they be in a classroom where they're required to sit for at least 5 to 10 minutes at a time? Some of them don't have the ability to attend. So attend means to pay attention to what something is, what a teacher is saying, or for, to an activity that is happening. If they are not attending, how can they learn? Another area that I work on is joint attention. So joint attention is to understand that in this group setting, when someone is speaking, they don't have to say my name and always get my attention. They're speaking to the group. So then I also have to be paying attention to that group. So these are the key areas really that that I help children with. Another area, of course, is what we call on-task behavior. So some children think, okay, fine, if I have to do letters, I'll do my cur, and then that's enough. But no, you've been given a page of cur. So then you need to continuously, so we call that continuous on-task behavior. So you need to continuously be working until that activity comes to an end. And even after that, you need to look around. You need to understand what is everyone else doing. Okay, they have kept their pencils down and they are waiting. So these classroom skills, that's a huge area that I work with. Another area, of course, would be social skills. A lot of children don't know how to interact appropriately with other, with their mainstream peers. So then it's teaching them those socially functional, socially appropriate behavior when it comes to playing a game, or if it could be just being in a classroom with someone else. So in terms of my preschool population, those are the areas that I work with. Then when it comes to my more elementary school and grade school populations, it could be another set of behavior. When it comes to adults, you know, like we discussed previously, Nimira, behavior therapy has come to Sri Lanka recently. So a lot of adults may have, you know, maladaptive behaviors that have now become habitual. So they've done it for so long that it actually takes quite a long time to then reverse those. So a lot of my adult clients, you know, that I work with trying to teach them socially appropriate behaviors when it comes to living in their own homes. Something that we are working on in the future, I'm trying to collaborate with, you know, other professionals in the field, is to come up with vocation skills training so that these individuals have something to do after the age of 18, so that they are not always at home. So behavior therapy is used in many places.
So it is very good to know, like it's not something like as we think, it's not something that we can do it in a day or in a week or in a month. So it's a elaborated thing. So it's good, and it's a good news, I think, for most of the parents that you must be wondering, okay, what's next after the school? So as you said, like if we can train them for vocational and then for all the other, like outside the elementary education, if we can train them for other skills, yes, which is a very good thing. And then like that would be a great hope for most of the parents.
I'm sure.
So Ishanti, when it comes to therapy, most of the parents, another famous question from the most of the parents is how long would it take, right? So even when they attend for speech therapy, one of the questions that they ask, how long would this take to finish? So I ask the same question from you. So if a child comes to you, is there any particular way that you can measure, or is there any particular flow that you are following? So how long would that, how long they would need to receive behavior therapy if they come to you? So what is the, I know that you can't say exactly a time frame, but like, is there any flow or is there any hierarchy that you would follow?
Well, I suppose it would depend on the reason they came to me. So for example, I mean, going back to functions of behavior, right? So if it was a skill deficit where they didn't know how to get attention properly, or they didn't know how to access an item properly, and we go ahead and we give them skills around that, then maybe if it's like a specific issue, it might be for a short time. But, you know, what I'm seeing right now is the skills that are required for preschool, we can go ahead and teach those skills, and the child can, you know, maintain those skills for some time. But once they reach a certain age limit or developmental milestone, it might be that they need a little bit of help to jump that hurdle. So that really, Nimira, that depends on a few factors. So it depends on the severity of the diagnosis, and it also depends on the individual's rate of learning. So there are some individuals who grasp what we're trying to teach them really quickly, and they learn those skills fast, and they learn how to apply them in the right situation really well. There are others who they might be a little bit what we call stubborn by nature. So, you know, they resist what we're trying to teach them. So it takes longer than for us to teach and for them to understand what we're trying to teach. And then the application process also takes a bit of time. Now, severity of the diagnosis also plays a role over here, because the more severe the diagnosis, the longer it will take for this child to understand and develop certain skills. Then again, when we talk about how long does an individual require therapy, you know, sometimes different age groups, different mental or developmental age groups have their own set of challenges. So we can help the preschool child learn prerequisite skills to be in the classroom. But now once they're in grade school, we see a small change in social interactions. So then they may be struggling with how to get involved in a group, how to maintain a relationship with another friend. So we can use behavior therapy to learn, to teach the child these skills that the child has unable to learn naturally. And then once the child has successfully learned them, we can then include them in more mainstream environments, such as, let's say, an art class, a singing class, a dance class, so that they can apply those skills in these more natural environments. But then talking about, you know, how long you have to do behavior therapy, like I said before, it depends on the developmental stage the child is in. So the child's own age, the child's social experiences, the child's physical maturity. So depending on the challenges that the child is facing in these different areas, connecting with your behavior therapist might be very useful, because we can isolate what the maladaptive behavior is, and then we can go ahead and teach a more appropriate behavior.
Okay. So when should the parent look for behavior therapy when it comes to the autism intervention?
Well, like all other therapies, Nimira, I would suggest that early intervention is key. Early intervention is best. When we talk about behavior, you know, we, as people get older, they get a little bit more hardwired. So that means certain behaviors become more habitual. It's the go-to thing for them to do. Now, if this is a positive behavior, that is great. But if this is a negative behavior, it just takes us a little bit longer then to unlearn and then relearn something new. So if you notice that your child is having certain challenges, meet with a behavior therapist, try and get it sorted as soon as you can. Because, you know, like we all say in all of our therapies, early intervention is key. You know, this again ties to how long does the child need therapy for. You get it done early, you can probably wrap it up much faster. If you wait a long time, you might need support for longer.
Okay, so as we all know, in autism, there's triad of impairments. So communication is affected, social interaction is affected, and they have some rigidity in their thoughts. So mostly this rigidity is misunderstood by the parents as well as the teachers, as the child is very stubborn and the child doesn't listen to us. He can do it, but he's not doing it. So in such situation, what is your advice for parents when it comes to the rigidity in their thoughts? So how we can address these type of issues?
So again, it boils down to function of behavior. So we have to understand, why is this child needing this kind of rigidity? And then once we understand what the function is, we can teach the child flexibility, or we can teach the child to do different things. But again, like I said, it all depends on what that function was. There is some kind of reason the child is required to behave like this. We'll understand that first, then we'll teach something more socially appropriate.
Okay. So I think I'm working with schools, and you're also working in schools. So mostly the teachers are sort of finding challenges when it comes to the temper tantrums. So are there any ways that we can help for teachers if a child is showing a tantrum? So how can a teacher help for that situation? Are there any tips that you can share with us at this situation?
Yes, so Nimira, that's the thing. Sometimes teachers really find themselves in a very difficult situation here, because they want to help the child, they want to help that family, but at the same time they have this vast curriculum to finish, right? So they have their own lesson plan that they have set for the day. So it's very difficult then for them to move away from teaching, let's say, 20 other students and dealing with this one student. Now, if it's a one-off, then maybe, okay, fine, maybe the teacher can, you know, find a way to catch up for that particular day's lessons in other lessons. But if it's a regularly occurring thing, this is a big problem, because the work is not being done. The entire class might not benefit from this situation, and the child is also not benefiting. So in this situation, you know, it's really, again, we go back to function of behavior, is understanding what is the function, why is this child behaving like this, and then trying to get help in isolation. So of course it's difficult to ask a mainstream typical teacher in the midst of all of her work, now you also have to do this work. So then what would be important is, if it's a skill deficit, we teach the child how to deal with this in a more clinical setting, then we apply it to a smaller group setting, and then we get the mainstream teacher support and say, look, these are some strategies that you can use. These are some of the child's triggers. When you notice that the child is, showing these kind of behaviors, it could mean that they need a break, or maybe you can get him closer to the teacher's table. But to ask the teacher to do this on her own, in the midst of having, you know, let's say 20 other children to teach and a lesson plan to cover, it might be a little bit challenging. So I hope that answers your question.
So if a child is showing a tantrum at home, how can a parent help? Is there any tips that you can share with us?
So again, like I said, it goes to functions of behavior. So now the behavior would be tantrum, right? Now if you take that behavior, tantrum, the child could be tantruming because they want access. Access to attention, access to a tangible. They could be tantruming because they want to escape or avoid a situation. So it's really behavior therapy is not about fixing that behavior, the tantrum. It's about understanding, why is the child tantruming? Because the tantrum itself is the child's communicating something is wrong, something is not going my way. So it's understanding, what is this message? And then we teach the child how to do it more appropriately, so that we see that tantrum behavior reduce. So we are reducing, or we are eliminating tantrum with something more socially appropriate. So again, to answer that question, it would, you know, it again boils down to functions of behavior. It's really important if the family, works with a behavior therapist, try and understand, what is my child trying to tell me when they are tantruming?
So we have some tailor-made intervention plan for that.
Exactly. So it's not a bag of tricks where, you know, let's try this, let's try that, let's try something else. Once you understand what the function is, then the problem is solved. Then we just go ahead and teach that, right?
So you can't use one strategy used for one child.
No.
It can't be generalized for another child.
It's difficult. Sometimes it might work, and that could be pure luck. Right, but otherwise, you know, it depends on the child's, like I said, the child's severity, the child's rate of learning, what the function is, and there are strategies for all of these things. So instead of, you know, wasting time trying 10 different things, why not figure out at once what do we need to do and then choose the right strategy for this, right?
So it's good, like we did a broader conversation about autism management and behavior therapy. So before we wind up, is there any message that you would like to give to our society? What do you want to say to our audience?
If you find that your child is having some kind of maladaptive behavior or having some challenges at home with your child, without first trying to label this with, you know, what is the diagnosis over here, just get help. Come and speak. If it's a speech related problem, get help with that. If it's a behavior related problem, get help with that, because not everything requires a diagnosis for you to get help. Especially in our society, families are a little bit reluctant to meet with a healthcare professional who might label the child with a diagnosis. But getting help doesn't require a label. Once, if you realize it's your child needs help with something, let's get the child that help. Let's solve this problem before it really becomes a bigger problem. So that is the advice that I can give. And like I said earlier, Nimira, you know, early intervention is key. Before these behaviors become habitual and hardwired, let's understand them sooner. And let's teach your child a more socially functional way of communicating faster. Because then it's easy for the child, it's easy for you, it's easy, right?
That's a very important message, Shanti, because as far as I have experienced in Sri Lanka, most of the families, they detect the problem at the beginning, like in the first stage of, in the first year of the child, but mostly they stay, this would go off in a couple of months, or they just think, no, my elder one is also was like this, and so this would be the same. So likewise, they are sort of taking time. So rather taking the time, early intervention is very important. So as Ishanti mentioned, if you feel your child is having some issues, and if you find that there are some challenging behaviors, your child is showing some sort of tantrumatic behaviors at home, the best thing is rather waiting at home, go to a trained person, consultant, and get the assessment done. So if there's any question related to today's topic about autism intervention and behavior therapy, you can always drop down a message or you can comment below. So we are there to help you, and I can always access to Ishanti and get your answers, get your questions sorted. So Ishanti, thank you very much for being a part here today and giving us a very good piece of knowledge. And I think it made our parents to think differently, and I hope this would be a greater initiative for most of our parents to think in a different way and to continue intervention in an appropriate way as well as early as possible. So thank you very much, and wishing you good luck with your work.
Thank you, Nimira. Most welcome, and good luck to you too. I think this channel, the means of sharing information with parents, is wonderful. I think it's a great way for different families who might, you know, feel the stigma of even meeting with someone. They now have access at home through the internet. So I think it's wonderful. So good luck for your show as well.